I am Gayle Laakmann McDowell, author of Cracking Coding Interview. Today we're going to cover binary search.
So binary search is a very intuitive algorithm, and I'm going to show how intuitive it is by giving an example. You're a teacher and you're teaching a group of students, a very large class of 300 students, and you have their papers alphabetized out in front of you when a student, Zach Peters, comes up to get his paper back. So you probably wouldn't go through the papers starting with Alex to Andy to Andrew and then to Bob and Brenda and Brandy and then to Chris and Christine, and you probably wouldn't do it that way. What you'd probably do is open the stack of papers to roughly halfway through the papers and compare it. Zach Peters, well, then you open up halfway through and you see Michael Matters there, and you'd say, okay, Zach Peters is after that name. And then you take the second stack of papers and you'd treat it as its own little stack, and you'd again say, okay, let me open up to its midpoint. Maybe we see Sarah. Well, is Sarah before or after Zach Peters? And then you just go and repeat this process over and over and over again until you find Zach's paper, or until you find out Zach can't be in here. And this is the basics of binary search. So on an integer array, it looks like this. You take some element that you're looking for, like 13, and you compare it to the midpoint. And it has to be a sorted array for this to work. It's very important. And you compare it to the midpoint. 13 is less than this midpoint. And so 13, if it's in the array at all, it has to be on the left side. And then you'd repeat this process on the left side and say, let me look at the midpoint of the left side. Is 13 before and after that? Before or after that? And you just repeat that process until you either find 13 or you know that 13 can't be in it. So how fast is this algorithm? Well, let's imagine we start off with n elements. So we have a search space of n elements. In a single comparison, just one, we've cut our search space down to n over 2. Then with one more comparison, we cut it down to n over 4. And then and half again, and half, and half, and half, and half again. So how many total operations, in the very worst case, will we have to run until we figure out if it contains an element or not? Well, the total number of operations we'll have to do is determined by how many times can we divide n by 2 until we get down to just 1. So this is what log of n expresses, or log base 2 of n expresses. So if you pause the video, you can study that math for a second and see the relationship between those two things. But this means that binary search is a log n problem. Let's look now at the implementation of binary search. To implement binary search, we can either implement it recursively or iteratively. We'll do a recursive implementation first. So I'm going to just copy and paste here some just straightforward code for the binary search call. So this is a initial method that calls off to this binary search recursive method with the right parameters. So we're going to start off initially with left being 0 and right being the very right point. So these are inclusive endpoints. So first of all, if things get kind of too big, if left winds up bigger than right, then we know we have an error, we can't find it, and we want to return true. Otherwise, we want to pick the midpoint, so left.right divided by 2, that's going to be the midpoint. And if we found the element, if array of mid is actually this element we're looking for, then we should return true. Otherwise, if x is on the left side of mid, then go search the left side. So pass an array, x, and left will stay as is, and the right point will move to one next to the mid. Otherwise, go search the right side. So we want to call a very similar method, but now the left point moves up to mid plus 1, and right stays as is. Okay, so that's how the binary search recursive implementation looks. So one little minor pitfall is that some people like to be careful of, is that left plus right can actually overflow it with Java integers. So if you'd like to avoid the integer overflow issue, you can actually just do this instead, and this will prevent the overflow. It's kind of up to you, but this is one way of doing it. Okay, so now that we've done the recursive implementation, let's turn to the iterative implementation. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to actually tweak this recursive implementation. I'm going to copy paste it into a new function, and I'm going to tweak it to make it iterative. So I'm going to call this iterative, and I no longer need parameters in here. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you how you can kind of tweak it. So I'm going to set left to be that right is going to start off at the rightmost position in the array. So now I want to iterate as long, I want to loop through this as long as left and right are essentially in the correct positions. So change this to a while loop. All right, and then if I exit here, then I haven't found it. Okay, so this looks correct. And then here, I don't want to actually recurse anymore. What I want to do is essentially take these values here. So left is going to stay as is, and right is going to move to mid minus one. I'm going to comment that out, and I'll delete it shortly. And then here, rather than, so left is going to stay, or left is going to become mid plus one, and right is going to stay as is. So that's how easy it is to tweak it from recursive to iterative. So that's how we implement binary search. Now remember that it can be implemented recursively or iteratively, and it can also be applied to other data like strings or something else, but it must always operate on something that's sorted. So now that you've seen the implementation of binary search, why don't you try to do binary search on a new data type like a string? Good luck.